We will use the bilinearity of this operator, and we are going to do the following. So I am going to pull out this term summation a goes from 1 to n ca, and what I would like you to notice is that this term is common actually for all the other terms. So I can pull this out, likewise from this integral as well I could pull this out, this is already there, and then this I could pull out. So I will put this one square bracket, and then the remaining term I could again pull out this one over here, the summation b goes from 1 to n, and I am left with na comma nb. So this I get from the first term, and this maybe I will pull the other ones on the right, on the left hand side. So this term would, I already have summation ca pulled out, and this would become then na comma f. The next term would be minus, I would have na 0 times h, and the final term is plus, because I am taking it to the left hand side, this would be a of na times n, n plus 1 times a g, and this is 0. I am going to call this quantity inside the bracket, the square bracket, as ga. So I can write this statement as summation a goes from 1 to n ca ga is 0, and this should hold for all arbitrary combinations of ca's, okay, because I have to satisfy this equation for all wh that belong to vh. I can now start arguing that maybe I take C1 as 1, and the other constants like C2, C3, C4, all of them, because they are arbitrary, the rest of them to 0, and then this equation will give me G1 would be 0. Next I can again take an arbitrary combination where C1 is 0, C2 is 1, C3, C4 all the way to Cn are 0. And then I would generate an equation that G2 is 0. So I hope you are able to appreciate that this would imply that Ga is 0 for all cases. So essentially when I try to write down the Galerkin form, I am able to get this equation here, Ga equal to 0 for all A, and A goes from 1 through n. So in fact I have generated n equations. So let me write that down. So this matrix form therefore would generate these equations. I would get A of na nb times db. I am sorry, I missed out a db here, so let me put it back here. There should have been a db here, so I put it back. So this db is actually equal to na comma f plus na 0 times h minus a of na n plus 1 times g, and this is for all a going from 1 to all the way to n. So notice what has happened. I have been able to get an explicit relationship. I know these basis functions. So na's, nb's are known to me. These are given to me. So therefore, I know this inner product as well. F is known to me, that is a function, so I can compute this, H is a quantity that is known to me. It's given as a boundary condition, so I can compute this. G is given to me, and so on. So this actually gives me a matrix equation system in terms of these DBs, which are the unknown, and I can solve for them and get an answer. So let's write this down in the following manner. So this results in a system of linear equations which I want to represent as KD equal to F. And you can see K is actually going to consist of these members KAB, and this is n by n, because A goes from 1 through n, B goes from 1 through n, and KAB is given as A of NA and B. D is the vector of unknowns. So this is given as DA, and this is n cross 1. So the vector D looks something like this: D1, D2, D3, all the way to DN. This is the vector of all unknowns. If I know all the DAs, if I can find them out, I can reconstruct my solution, because if you remember, my UH is given as summation B goes from 1 to n plus 1 DB NB. So NBs are the functions that are given to me, DBs I can calculate, and then I can estimate what is UH. F is the force vector, the right hand side, and this consists of these quantities FA. This is also of the size n cross 1, n rows, only one column, and a typical FA is actually all this quantity on the right hand side. So let me rewrite it for you. So that's NA comma F, that's from the force, applied force. Then I have a contribution from the Neumann boundary condition or the natural boundary conditions, and finally I have a contribution from the Dirichlet boundary condition, which is how does this equation system look. So when I write KD equal to F, actually I am talking about a matrix system which is n by n. This is K, so I would have a K11, K12, all the way to K1n, and here I would have K21, K22, all the way to K2n, and so on, and the final row would be KN1. KN2 all the way to KNN. This is my K matrix, and this would hit the vector D. So this is my D, which is n cross 1, and the entries of this we have already seen. These are D1, D2, D3, all the way to DN, and then on the right hand side I have the vector F. And this is n cross 1, so this is F1, F2, F3, all the way to Fn. There is a name given for this in finite elements. This is known as the stiffness matrix. So K in general is called the stiffness matrix, even though we may be doing heat transfer or we may be doing fluid mechanics. But the name stiffness matrix has stuck on, because initially the method was applied to solid mechanics. So that's the stiffness. D is known as the displacement vector, or we can call it the generalized displacement vector. In fact, in fluid mechanics, it would be the velocity vector if you are solving in terms of velocity of the fluid or the pressure. In case of heat transfer, it could be temperature field, so it could be the temperature. And F is known as the force vector. So these are just names that have stuck on. So the displacement is what is the unknown. So D is, so the D vector is the unknown vector and needs to be determined. And it's very easy to solve for that. In fact, you can write that D is simply K inverse F. So let me summarize for you the matrix form. So let me summarize the matrix form for you. So formally, we are going to write it like this, that given the matrix K and force vector F, I am supposed to find the displacement vector D such that KD is equal to F. So this we will call as the matrix form. The solution to M is given as D is K inverse F. So you can recall that UH was given as VH plus GH. VH we wrote down as B goes from 1 to N. dB and B, and GH was given as G as NN plus 1. So once we know all the dBs, we already know G, we know all the functions, so we should be able to calculate UH. So UH is known after dBs have been computed. Notice that the choice of the basis functions that means NBs and the dimension N, it determines the approximation. Okay. So the idea is very simple. So you are trying to set up a approximate method and you want to get UH. So you set out by choosing a set of basis functions and N of them. If you want a better approximation, you have two options. One is you can increase the number of functions. Okay, that's one way. The other is you can say, no, I will keep the number of functions same, but I will choose better functions. So one example of that would be, I could start by choosing NBs to be P piecewise linear functions. And in the next stage, I could say, well, I want to use piecewise quadratic approximation or piecewise cubic approximations. So that would be one way of increasing the accuracy. The other could be I stay with piecewise linear functions. Maybe initially I was choosing 20 of them, and in the next stage I can choose 100 of them. Okay, so that's how these methods work, and we are going to look at them. I now want to talk about some properties of K. So some general remarks. So if I look at KD equal to F, can I make some statement about K? So the first one is that K is symmetric. How is that? Well, KAB, I just showed you, is given as A of NA comma NB, which actually is integral from 0 to 1 NA comma X NB comma X DX. KBA is A of NB comma NA, which is actually integral of 0 to 1 NB comma X and A comma X. And you can see from this that KAB is equal to KBA. So this is something good that has come out of the formulation. Please recall, we are able to do this because we integrated the strong form by parts once. So recall, in the strong form, the equation was u comma xx plus f equal to 0. And then we went ahead and said w times u comma xx plus f dx is 0 from 0 to 1. And then we integrated by parts once to get terms like integral w comma x u comma x and other terms. So because of the symmetric nature of this operator, we are able to find a symmetric stiffness matrix. Suppose we had not integrated by parts, we had left it as it is. Then, as you can see, I would get a term like NA from this and NB comma XX, and that would not be symmetric anymore. So if I chose the weak form where I do not integrate by parts, then I would end up with a matrix system where K is not symmetric. And as we know that it is much easier to solve a symmetric equation system, it requires less resources, computational resources. Let me review for the steps so far. Always a good idea to keep in mind. So there was a strong form, and we said that this is equivalent to the weak form. Then we approximated this to the Galerkin form by taking finite dimensional spaces. And then once we have the Galerkin form, we chose some basis functions. And then we were able to derive a matrix form. So this is where we are, and you can see it is an approximation to the strong form and it is an approximation to the weak form. We'll stop here, and in the next class we are going to look at some examples of this method by choosing different values of n and seeing how the method performs. Thank you.